How is everyone? If you're still alive, that's pretty good, actually. I happen to be still alive, and feeling pretty good. I had some wonderful dreams last night. Woke up today. My back, terrible back pain is gone. I had some energy today. I was functioning well, I feel. And as a matter of fact, I woke up today with a different, subtly different perception, actually. And the day was just like a revelation, the entire day. And it continues. So I have said that the times we are in are really bad. There's no question about it. I mean, incredibly bad. It is a death trap. We are in a death trap in this planet right now. I've also said that there is a remedy for this. For sure there's a remedy for this. I've seen it, and I saw myself taking this remedy. I always have. What is the remedy? I have said it's quote-unquote extreme right brain subjectivity, some kind of wholeness. Extreme right brain wholeness is actually the answer. And I've said we have to get into that right now, just right away. Well, today I sort of got into it, actually. So these efforts, all out efforts, actually are paying off. And I was able to ask questions and focus and feel different than I ever have, for sure, in terms of pure spaciousness. And I understood how everything simply abides in this ground of being. And the whole right brain understanding of this was there the whole day, really. Very subtle, but I noticed there's something a little bit different. Can't really put my finger on what it is, but I came home and I typed in pure spaciousness as a search query, and I came across some words, a little stanza of words that seemed to encapsulate exactly what I've been feeling today and aware of today. I said, wow, you know, that's amazing. I didn't know who they're by or anything. I said, you know, whoever wrote these words, they really get it, that is for sure. And so there is an answer. Now, who wrote those words? I eventually said, well, who wrote those words? I was a little bit interested in, huh? You know, some person I never heard of before. And some person from the 14th century Tibet. I said, what? I said, yeah, wow. I've said before that there have been some real great spiritual masters in Tibet. There's no question about it. And wow, this one who wrote those words happens to be one of those. And I said, holy smokes. I mean, I had instant rapport with what was written. I said, that's exactly spot on. That's exactly what I'm aware of today. It was just amazing. The fit was just incredible. So I said, wow, thank you. You know, when the student is ready, the guru appears, I guess. Not externally. Nothing happened externally, but I came across this writings by someone who's actually regarded extremely highly in Buddhism, often called the second Buddha. So, and I could tell that this one is absolutely spot on. I'm positive that this one is enlightened. Absolutely, there's no question about it. But amazingly, I was able to completely understand what they're saying exactly, just fit like a glove of my experience here today. So I was very right-brained, right-minded, so to speak, today. Very much so. And easily. And so there is a way to get into it. Obviously, I'm succeeding. So that's the first thing, is don't give up. There is some way to get into it. So we will keep pressing this all out. I say everybody who can go all out. What we need is the presence of this right-mindedness in the world, the presence of it, to help others get into it. It is possible. It is absolutely possible. This will absolutely save us from these times we live in, which we need salvation from these times. These are the wicked times that have been foretold as the end of this age, the Kali Yuga. You know, these are those times. And I'm telling you, we got to go for it. And so how do we go for it? I'm trying. I am going for it. Just about died attempting. But I, miraculously, I feel better today. Just miraculously. It's like, wow. You know, just amazing. And the breakthrough happened. The breakthrough happened. Very subtle. But I suddenly was thinking in these terms of pure spaciousness. And it all made sense to me. And I understood the ground of being. And how everything has always been intrinsically already abides in that ground of being. Nothing needs to be saved. Everything has always been that way. And on and on and on and on and on. Just, you know, pure clarity on all of this. And then I read this stanza by this great Tibetan guru and saying the exact same thing. And he says, this is the ultimate. This is the fast path. This is what you do. You don't need all that other stuff. He's saying, just this right now. And so this is the fast path. This is the, we're on a fast path here. We don't have any time for anything other than that. So there is a way to talk in this pure, right-minded type of way that gets one into the right hemisphere, so to speak, that can see everything in a totality way, okay? Definitely we can do that. Instead of the left brain stuff, need to de-emphasize that. It is doable. It is doable for us. And I put on intense effort recently, and it just absolutely, I was just knocked out. And so somehow today, I'm on my feet again, which is really, really great news for me, that is for sure. The way of speaking that we need to entertain is something that the left brain simply can't handle at all. But we don't need for the left brain to handle it at all. It's not necessary. All we need to be is reminded of reality. We don't need to have it explained. But I had a dream, and I was taking video of all these beautiful flocks of birds in the beautiful azure sky, just this gorgeous sky with some wonderful clouds, and the birds were flying, and I was taking video trying to follow this murmuration of a flock of birds flying around. And in this dream, I was following like this, and like this, and like this, and like this, and the birds were just moving all over the place. And suddenly an idea came to me. He said, hey, wait a minute. Why don't you just go wide angle, full sky, on a tripod, and just static shot, and then everything that's happening in the sky is going to be recorded on the, right? Everything. And then later, if you want to, you can zoom in on whatever you want to. So you're not going to miss anything if you go full sky. And I suddenly realized that that's the way to go. Full sky. And then I started realizing, wait, you know, those birds, what are they flying through? Space. Are they moving space? Are they affecting space? Is anything in space affecting pure spaciousness? And this meditation spontaneously started arising within my mind. And it just continued and continued and continued. And during the daytime, I just had this feeling of understanding of all this very clearly. Still do. It's you know, I'm very tired in the end of the day, and a lot of chaotic stuff going on. It's all the time. I was working real hard today, and but it's still you know, resonant within me. Feel it. There's a feeling. Also had a dream where I was trying to swim across this river, very tough river to swim across. I almost got to the other side, and suddenly this extreme current was pushing me away from the bank. I couldn't get on there, but I went downstream a little bit to where the bank came into the river a little more, grabbed a hold of the embankment, the sheer embankment, and pulled myself over eventually to the landing place and was able to cross that river. So there's a lot of inner stuff that's been going on lately that's showing that there's something very profound. And it's necessary for us now to seize the moment of deciding to go all in to this extreme right-minded perspective, actually. Extreme right-minded perspective, okay? Not just this, you know, pop psychology right-minded stuff. I'm talking about extreme right-minded perspective, which sees, it's amazing. What I saw today and what I felt today is true, is truth. Everything arises inherently within this ground of pure being, of pure spaciousness, of that which all motion and activity take place in, and yet that motion and activity do not cause any motion and activity in this, you know, pure spaciousness. And I've come at this from my own organic path. It's not something, I didn't come at it from Buddhism or Christianity or this or this or that. It's just from clarification. But now here I see that this great Buddhist master reached this conclusion long ago. And saw it perfectly. There's no question that this is someone who saw it perfectly and was abiding in that, no question about it. So I say, wow, you see, it's all the same. It's all the same. Everything has always abided, and there's nowhere for it to go. There's no place else for it to abide. But I've put it into the context, modern context, and it all fits perfectly well with right now. We can use our terminology if we like, it's not a problem. And I'll read something, a little bit of this, from what this teacher said. This is from a book by Keith Downman, so this is just fair use here. We're going to read a little bit. Book is titled Spaciousness, something along those lines. Matter and spirit are the same in intrinsic spaciousness, and Buddha and sentient beings are the same in intrinsic spaciousness, and absolute and relative are the same in intrinsic spaciousness, and sin and virtue are the same in intrinsic spaciousness. And the 10 directions are all the same in intrinsic spaciousness. Consequently, everything arising as self-sprung display, at its inception, all the same, nothing ever better or worse. What is the use of positive or negative antidotes? In their abiding, all things are the same, nothing ever better or worse. So let whatever arises in the mind subside into itself right now. In their release, all things are the same, nothing ever better or worse. So in the aftermath, why make any judgment? And it's just like, I read this and it's just like, yeah, that's exactly what I've been talking about for years. But all condensed down into this beautiful streamlined format. And it's like, yeah, we are on the right path. There's no question. This is confirmation of it. All attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally meaningless, but allow everything that arises to subside within itself without any judgment. And this would lead to quiet mind for sure. So there's many ways we can get to it with different terminology, etc. But it's all pointing to the very same thing. Seeing these birds fly today, I walked outside the door And I saw these beautiful white birds flying one after the other right overhead up in the beautiful blue sky, and went on and on. And I said, wow, are the birds, is space moving? Do birds move space? Does space move? Does pure space move? The birds are simply within this space. We are in this with space. Everything is within space. Even the universe is within this space. The entire universe is within this spaciousness. It's the intrinsic nature of mind, this pure spaciousness. Now, Muji talks about this. For some reason that, you know, it all of this sort of spontaneously arose within me this morning after this dream. And I now understand it, whereas before I didn't understand what they're talking about. So you can't really get it academically. Somehow, through your efforts to clarify context, it will dawn on you that all this makes sense. It all, you say, yeah, of course. How could it be otherwise? But as soon as you go into the left brain, you can't understand it anymore. You really cannot. That's why I'm saying we have to dwell within the right brain now. You cannot, you're not trying to mix the two, combine the two. No. That is, you will for sure, it will make sense to you. You'll say, there's something wrong with that. I don't quite understand it. But there's nothing wrong with it. It's obvious. Before I went to bed last night, I looked at this poster. And I practiced just diffuse looking at nothing directly. Don't look at anything directly. This is called like spaciousness. It is, you're not trying to pin anything down. You're not trying to grasp anything. You're not trying to identify everything, because we dwell within the one identity. There's only one identity, which is this pure spaciousness. And everything abides in it already. Everything already abides in it. So I may have said this the last video. I was in church yesterday, and I was thinking about I was thinking along certain lines of letting go, and of this search for identity, this massive effort to build an identity, and I started feeling very sad. And I said, "Wow, you know, I won't have any identity anymore. You know, it's terrible. What am I going to do?" And then suddenly the realization came that you would realize that everything is abiding in the one identity. So that's the realization. It's not a realization of my identity. It's not like we have an identity as a self. It's that everything that can ever possibly arise, or ever will arise, ever has arise endlessly, arises within the one identity of pure spaciousness. And therefore, you experience that. And the burden that it takes off you is just amazing. You don't have to try and construct an identity. See, we're trying to construct an identity, a separate identity, identity separate from the spaciousness, as if the spaciousness is contained within this identity. And it's impossible. So the attempt to give up the impossible, and you think, oh, I'm going to lose the sense, my sense of self, the centerless self. I'm not going to have a center to myself. I'll be lost. That's what I was almost crying. I said, I'd be lost. And then this realization came, no. It's not that you will find yourself. It's that you will find the one self, and you'll find that everything is equally abiding within this one self. Equal, everything's in spaciousness, isn't it? Every last thing is equally in space, spaciousness, equally. And that's just the fact of it. That is the identity. This pure spaciousness abiding in that, that is identity. And we all have this one identity. It's not like we all are one, like my self is one with yourself, is one with yourself. No, it's not like that. It's like that there's only one identity. There's not many identities as one. There's only one identity. And we all abide in this one identity. Everything does. So everything is already saved, liberated, free. There's nothing, nothing has to happen at all. The birds are already in space. They're flying. They're already there. We're already there. The sky is within spaciousness. The planet is dwelling within the spaciousness. Everything is. And it can't ever be other than that. There's nowhere for it to go. There's nowhere for anything to go. Nothing needs to go anywhere for this to be true. Nothing has to happen for this to be true. It's already always has been the case, always will be the case. And so all this is just like now arising. And it's a right brain realization for sure. If you go into the left brain, it'll be gone. You won't see it. Because the left brain is trying to be subtle and clever, whereas the right brain just is just abiding. There's this abidance there. It's very simple. It sees the obvious. The left brain overlooks the obvious for the non-obvious in an attempt to be the origin of this spaciousness. We're trying to be greater than the prime creator, of this pure spaciousness. You might call it the prime creator. And we're trying to be greater than that. So we ignore it. And try to say that it's coming from us. So it's, so we're trying to be subtle. We can't see it. The right brain is not subtle. It simply accepts the complete obviousness of it. It's totally obvious that everything is abiding in spaciousness. So there was a subtle difference to this day, there's no question about it. And then coming across this guru, I called him my friend. Immediately I said, whoever wrote this is a friend of mine, that is for sure. We're of one mind. We see things, seeing this the same way. Seeing this, he's obviously seeing this exactly what I've seen, but seeing it more clearly for sure. He's established in it, most likely very established in it. So I said, hey, that's great. So extreme right-mindedness at this time is essential, because the left brain, what's going on in the world now is, beyond pathetic, actually. There's a lack of recognition of this fact, the fact of identity. There's a lack of recognition of this, extreme lack of recognition of this. Read a little more here. Another kind of stanza here. Canto, they call it. In short, all conscious sensory perception, all that is unconscious or transcendent, everything is already released in the spaciousness of the now. So any attempt to liberate anything anew is superfluous. It is pointless to try to make effort towards release. So don't try. Don't try. Don't struggle and strive and practice. Don't seek. Don't seek. Don't seek intellectual truth. Don't meditate. Don't meditate. Don't contrive meditation. Don't analyze. Don't analyze. Don't analyze in or after an event. Don't practice. Don't practice. Don't practice the upshot of hope and fear. Don't reject. Don't reject. Don't reject emotional karma. Don't believe. Don't believe. Don't believe in righteous religion. Don't trap yourself. Don't trap yourself. Don't cage your mind. Wow. Thank you. Really, thank you for somebody in the 14th century in central Tibet incredible words for these times right now. It's just like, wow. It's like custom made for these times. This teacher is custom made for these times. It's just, what I experienced in a dream was the being caged in, trapped in this mind, so to speak, of these times. And as I realized it's a death trap. And I was able to see in the extreme rightmost part, there was a narrow way to escape it. And these words right here are it. Because they're saying, drop all this effort right now. Because everything is already abiding in the spaciousness without any effort whatsoever. Today, I realize there is no jumping off point. The jumping off point is to realize there is no jumping off point. There's nothing, nowhere to jump to. We're already within the spaciousness. So there is no jumping off point. It's the relaxation of effort that results in realization, right-mindedness, and realization, in safety, refuge from this storm that's taking place in the world. There's nothing that needs to be grasped. Everything's already in the grasp of the one identity. So we release your efforts from trying to grasp something. Everything's already home. Everything's already home. Nothing ever left home. There's never been any leaving of home. It's never taken place. Never. Never will be. So we're gearing up, like to take this big jump. What are we jumping into? We're already in spaciousness. Can we jump somewhere can we jump out of spaciousness? Can we jump into it? We're already there. We don't need to take any jump. Just as we are, right where we are, we're completely within it. In Christianity, it's called the everlasting arms. Leaning on the everlasting arms. It's pure spaciousness, not just spaciousness, pure spaciousness. Now we can abide in the realization of this. We don't necessarily have to realize pure spaciousness, just pure spaciousness in itself. There's this intermediate step of the overlay, as I say, where we see everything is already abiding, total abidance. Not just us. It's enlightenment is the seeing that everything is abiding. Already abiding. There's continuous, seamless abidance. How can it not be seamless? Where can something go to be non-seamless? Is there some seam in pure spaciousness where you go where you're not in pure spaciousness? Can something hide, you know, we're hiding, and we say we're not in pure spaciousness. We could go to dig a hole, you know, but the hole is within spaciousness, isn't it? The world is within pure spaciousness. Everything is. It's inescapable. Yeah, so it's all seamless. There's no seams to it. There's no seams to pure spaciousness. Even a seam is dwelling within that pure spaciousness. So you see, it's easy to listen to this and say, yeah. The right mind gets it. The right mind gets it. Say, oh, yeah, no problem with this. It's obvious. The problem is when we go to the left mind and try to explain it to the left brain. Don't try to explain it. Don't try to explain it. Forget it. Just keep dwelling in the right mind. Don't go into the left brain. Because the left brain says that spaciousness exists within it. That it is the origin, or it is building something which is outside of the spaciousness, and just forget it. You don't have to remember. You don't have to convince anything of the truth because the truth is already true. You don't have to convince a tree that it's dwelling in spaciousness. You don't have to convince a person that they're dwelling in spaciousness. You don't have to do any convincing. They already are You just have to recognize it. If they want to deny it, fine. It doesn't change anything. We only need to be reminded of the spaciousness. We don't need to convince anyone. And here's another thing, a very powerful, powerful realization, is nobody has to prove anything to me. Okay, this turns things around in such an incredible way, I don't even know what to say. Just say this mantra. Nobody needs to prove anything to me. Nothing has to prove anything to me. I don't need anything to prove anything to me. So I'm not waiting for anything to prove itself to me in any way. Nothing has to prove anything. Everything already abides in the spaciousness. I found that we're waiting for someone to prove something to us. And that's what's keeping us waiting. I want somebody to prove something to me. No, nobody has to prove anything to me. Nobody has to prove anything to me. So you free everything up. Everything's free. You're not waiting. You're not saying, hey, you need to prove something to me. No. Nothing has to prove anything to me. So the goal is to dwell more and more simply in this state. This makes total sense. You say, of course, obvious. You're not trying to evangelize the left brain. Okay, forget it. It is what it is. It is what it is. We just don't need it. We don't need it. Just use it for practical purposes, of course. But that's all. Don't ask its opinion on this. Don't try to teach it anything. Waste of time. Because it'll start seeking and believing. What does it say? Don't believe. And it will start doing all those things, you know. It'll try, it will seek, it will meditate, it will analyze, it will practice. There's no need to practice anything. Do we need to practice something in order to get into the spaciousness? It's like we're not there yet. And those birds flying across the sky, say, well, they're not in the spaciousness yet, but they're flying towards it. Is there some goal? We reach it, we say, okay, now we're in the spaciousness. So I'm very grateful for this teacher, you know, to show up in my life like that. It's like, wow, I just love the way that he puts things. It's just perfect. Just like a glove, just wonderful. You never know what's going to show up, right? The key is perception. You can practice it of diffuse awareness. Everything is there in your field, okay? But you're not focusing on anything in particular. You're not naming anything, you're not measuring anything, you're not judging anything, you're not practicing anything, you're not seeking, you're not trying, you're not meditating. You're just allowing everything in your perceptual field to be there equally. You're not singling anything out. You can practice that. Just sitting in your chair, you can just practice that. This is like total sky, wide angle lens. Everything is there equally, right, in this way of looking. It's all there. Everything is equally in spaciousness, isn't it? Is there something that is less in spaciousness than something else, or something that is more in spaciousness than something else? So, just practice it. This is completely easy. You just simply are not trying to focus on anything in particular, not trying to single anything out, not trying to exclude anything. Just diffuse, just let everything just be there in your perception. That's all. this puts you right into your right mind. Puts you right into your right brain right away. And then just keep doing that. I do that as I'm speaking here, you know, in the video, pretty much so. I'm still able to function perfectly well, cook your food, eat your food, do everything's fine. But the predominant mode is this right brain mode. The right brain mode now is predominating. It's in charge now. And the left brain is just a servant. You know, it's quiet. It functions when it, you know, needs to function. But other than that, no. If something goes faster in the sky, you know, like a rocket, is that escaping spaciousness? Is there some speed that escapes spaciousness? Does light escape spaciousness? Can we go slow? Can we just like stop and we say, I'm not in spaciousness, I'm not moving at all, I'm not in spaciousness anymore? So what was the point of making the efforts, you know, to realize, to be in it, or out of it, or anything? What's the use of that? And this is the immediate, direct, right now way of simply abiding in it. Ramana said, abide in the self. The self means this pure spaciousness. Some call it pure awareness. I feel a little more comfortable calling it pure spaciousness, at least today. Who knows what tomorrow will bring. Some say pure consciousness, whatever, but yeah, there's different ways of referring to it, but I like the spaciousness because you can directly see things, all right? Now, some talk about thoughts also abiding in this spaciousness, but from a pragmatic standpoint, it's all the same. And what was said here? Everything that arises subsides into itself without any judgment. Yeah. In their abiding, all things are the same. Nothing ever better or worse. Nothing ever better or worse. Ever, right? You see, it doesn't matter what the dance is. It's all, the whole dance is taking place within this pure spaciousness. Always. So let whatever arises in the mind within this, you know, spaciousness, everything that we're perceiving, whatever arises in the mind, subside into itself right now. Subside into itself right now. How about that? So let it, everything just subside into itself. See, the left brain wants to immediately start a process going of construction, constructing, building a self. But the right brain says, let everything that arises simply subside back into itself. You know, you're not trying to connect it to something else. Just allow whatever it is, just allow it then to subside back into itself, into the pure nature of the one identity, which it is abiding in. So just recognize its abidance. It is abiding. It already is abiding. What does it need to do to abide in the one identity? Nothing. So do you need to pursue this thought, this motion, this feeling, this perception? Do you need to add on to it? Do you need to subtract from it? Do we need to do any of this? And this teacher said, no. So this is golden advice for us right now. And can we realize this? Absolutely, of course. There's nothing to realize. It already is true. We just need to abide in this truth instead of trying to deny it. Denial of it brings the left brain into action. We say, hey, left brain, you know, we want something different. Can you work on that? Left brain says, sure. And then immediately. But it's just a trick of the mind. There's what even confusion is within spaciousness, right? Even chaos is within this pure spaciousness. Pure, total chaos is still within this pure spaciousness, so it doesn't affect it at all. The feeling is the same. The feeling of this pure spaciousness is unaffected by any dance that's going on, even pure chaos, or some kind of pure order, you know, where we've ordered everything, numbered everything. It has no effect. Now, there are all sorts of subtleties that can be generated along these lines, but we don't need any of them. That's the whole point. We don't need them. We don't need it. We don't need to generate some vast library of subtle teachings at all. We only need to be reminded of this pure spaciousness of reality. And that's it. There can be commentaries, all these commentaries, books, writings, subtleties, divisions, lineages, all, none of that's necessary. Forget all of it. Forget it. Forget all meditations. Forget all righteous religions. Forget all paths. Where are these righteous religions, these paths, these meditations? Where are they arising? What are they abiding in? The self-same pure spaciousness as anything else and everything else. So everything's home already. There's no separation. Nothing's separated. There's no separation. What else needs to be known? What else needs to be realized? Is something else? No. That too abides in the same, self-same, pure spaciousness. So there's a tendency to say, okay, what's next, what's next? What's next? Why does there need to be a next? Why does there need to be time? In other words, a change in what is. A measurement of change. It's all hypothetical. And the hypothetical, too, is within the spaciousness. Hypothetically, what if there weren't the spaciousness? That, it too, is within the spaciousness. No, we don't need time. We don't need to measure motion. You know, time, really, the measurement of motion, you could say. The bird is flying, now it's here, and then it's over here, and it took some time. But isn't the bird here, and the bird here, isn't the bird always within the spaciousness? So does that fact need to be measured? Does that fact need some kind of overlay of time to understand it, to be what it is? Or does it need some calculation? What kind of mathematics are needed for that fact? Is anything farther away or closer to the spaciousness? Is anything moving into it or out of it? Is it... All this activity, is it really need to be measured and analyzed and judged and, you know? None of that's necessary at all. So there doesn't need to be any mental activity whatsoever to recognize this abidance. It doesn't require another moment, some other moment. A moment to measure, a moment to assess, a moment to judge. It's not necessary. There's nothing that needs to be judged or assessed or measured. So all this is just, you know, abiding in the right brain, right-mindedness, coming from that. don't go over to the left brain. And the left brain said, how is this going to help me? Don't go there. How is this going to help me? That's a trap. Because who are you explaining the help to? Is there something that is separate that needs help? So don't let the egoic mind, as it were, pull you in that direction, even though it may seem difficult to resist. Just continue to abide in the right mindedness. Have faith that it does provide the answer. It will provide the answer. It's there. I have faith in that. I saw it. I actually experienced it in the dream. I was able to run up these stairs, get up onto this higher level, and there everything is, there was just this beautiful feeling of spaciousness and peace and calm, and there was no death trap there, that is for sure. How can anything die to this spaciousness? Where does it go? Is there some place it can go? Does it disappear from this? Can something disappear from the spaciousness? Where can it go? These are questions that can arise. Part of abiding in the right mind and this right brainness is don't answer questions. Don't try to answer questions. Just hear the question and just let it subside into itself. Let whatever arises, even all these explanations, let them subside into themselves. You're not trying to find an answer. You're just listening. You're just hearing. You're just abiding. Does spaciousness need an answer? Is it looking for answers? Does anything need an answer? Everything is already abiding in the one identity. What is the answer that anything needs? Does anything need an answer? So again, don't say, yes, or no, I'm not sure. No, don't try to answer anything. Don't try to, it goes immediate left brain. Don't do that. You immediately lose the feeling. It's gone. Like you try to answer something. If there's a question, well, you know, what is the cube root of, 23,866,723,124,347? What is the 27th cube root of that or something? You just say, well, hey, okay, just let that question abide in itself and subside in itself. And just enjoy the question. Right? Who needs an answer? Does spaciousness need an answer? Do we need an answer to be in spaciousness? Is that going to establish us in spaciousness? Do we need to be established in it? Are we not already in it? Have we ever not been in it? So why do we need to establish ourselves in it? To come up with answers, that means we're now in it, or we're more in it. Can we be more in it or less in it? Depending on what we do, what we say, what we think, what we calculate. Is there some way? Is there any way? There's no way. There is no way. There's never been any way. So, and let that too subside within itself, in itself. So let whatever arises in the mind subside into itself right now. Beautiful. There's a plane that's flying across. Okay, it's going to some city somewhere. Now, it's going to that city, are you now more or less in the spaciousness? Is traveling somewhere get you closer or farther away? Is there somewhere you can go get farther away from it or closer to it? Now, well, I mean, no answer to that. Let it subside, but there is no way. So, is there a way? No, there is no way. There's no way. There is no way. And just abide in this, there is no way. Therefore, there's nothing you need to get. You don't need to find the way, because there is no way. There's never been a way. Just feel this sitting, abiding in itself, this statement. Just whatever comes up, just let it sit within itself. And then just feel it. And it's like, wow. Right brain, right? There is no way. That's pure right brain. Pure to the farthest reaches. There is no way. There isn't any way. We don't need a way. There is no way. No way needed. No way needed, and there is no way. Just let this sit in. Now, in Jesus' Last Supper, he points out this here. He says, do this in remembrance of me. This is what you need to do symbolically. Eat the unleavened bread. Meaning nothing left brain, nothing bubbling up, fermenting, no time needed there, you know, no process. Stay in the right brain, unleavened. Stay in the unleavened state. And then the wine takes a little time to produce, right? So he's saying the effects of this, doing this, will take a little bit of time before it really sets in. So you just have to be patient. Be patient. Abide in the right, extreme right brain state, and then be patient that the benefits of this somehow it will blossom, the flower will blossom. Don't try to force it. Don't try to grab it, grasp it. There is no way. Abide in that realization, there is no way. And with patience, this will, your perspective will shift a little bit, like it did for me this morning. I woke up this way in the morning and I said, hey, something's a little bit different. I feel different, but it's very subtle and gentle. So much so, you say, maybe I'm just imagining that. It's probably just the same. So, but it's a little bit different, you know. But it's so gentle and subtle, you really, you know, but you feel like, I seem to be tuned into something here that's more attuned to something here. I'm more attuned to it today for some reason. All right, so, but don't force it. In other words, let this, there is no way, just let it sit there. Don't try to do anything with it. Just let it sit there. Don't try to say, hey, I got it. Or, you know, I understand there's no way here. That goes left brain. They want a product. Forget about the product. There is no product. There is no product. And no one needs to prove anything to us, do they? No one needs to give us a product either. We don't need a product. The spaciousness is the product. We already have the product that we're looking for. All right. Very great. We have to just keep it going. Keep it going. In Jesus' advice to us, do this, he said, in remembrance of me. Absolutely. Do this. Keep doing it. And it will begin to flower. It will begin to flower. Just let it flower. Don't just say, okay, it's flowering. Let that too just be what it is. And just keep abiding in this practice, in this perspective. seems to be getting easier. Yeah, the more that we do this, the easier it gets, for sure. Absolutely. Just in the nick of time. Yeah, I don't even want to talk about what's going on in the world. No, we're not going to talk about it. We already know. You know, if your house is on fire, you get out of the house. You know, you don't sit around. You know, you just get out. I mean, I don't need to talk about it. The house is on fire. The house is on fire right now. The world is on fire with deceit and lies and confusion and hostility and agitation and all those things that we don't want. So it is a conflagration right now, as we were told will happen, and it's happening. So get out of that house and get into this extreme right-mindedness right now. And just keep at it, you know, like someone running from a burning fire. But don't burn yourself out. I did burn myself out, but I seem to be bouncing back, hopefully. It was very much touch and go there, really drastic effort. That I said, I don't know if I'm going to survive this. And at this point, it you know, we'll see. But so far, I'm surviving, and we'll keep on making this effort. And everybody make the greatest effort they can right now to drop effort, to accept there is no way. There is no way. How can there be a way? All right. And don't let the left mind grab a hold of this and say, what do you mean by no way? Again, that's not just allowing it to. What? So let whatever arises in the mind subside into itself right now. In their release, all things are the same. Nothing ever better or worse. So in the aftermath, why make any judgment? Why make any judgment? You see, if we try to make something up, we're afraid, this, I don't want the judgment. I need to make it better. I need to do something. No, nothing has to happen. Nothing has to be done. That's why there is no way. All right, very great. That's it.